All the cattle are standing like statues. All the cattle are standing like statues. They don't turn their heads as they see me ride by. But a little brown maverick is winking her eye. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day.
Hi, everybody. This is Dr. Ed Park, and I'm going to do a webinar on the voice. So, this is a picture of the three tenors. I still don't know. I want to say Caruso and Bocelli, but... I know. It'll come to me. So I was an anthropology major, so these things interest me, the evolution of man. So one thing that is always noted is that the tongue of man is different. It's like a seven, like a right angle. So it's equally long as it is deep down into the vocal tube, and that allows us to do a lot of really cool things with it. Also, human speech is modality independent, or language is modality independent. Birds can't gesture or do other things to make themselves heard. Neither can whales or dolphins. They need the voice. So whereas people can draw what they mean or play charades and gesture them out, language is independent of that. Apes have better table manners than humans because they can't talk and eat at the same time, whereas humans can because of a variety of things, but excellent control of our tongue, epiglottis, etc. We evolved from... probably a common ancestor that was nocturnal, like lemurs have wet noses, and then we became haplorhino or dry nosed, and that allowed for the face to be less big because hearing was not as important in the day, sight was, and that our lips got bigger and could be more versatile. The event that created Homo sapiens happened about 250,000 years ago. Nobody knows what it is, but at that time it's thought that language also involved and the structures needed for language. Phonemes, such as A, E, I, O, U, and consonants, and all the sounds. It goes from a rainforest tribe with only 11 phonemes to the Gung people, the Bushmen of the Kalahari, who have 141 phonemes. And I like this quote, which is, primate social intelligence is Machiavellian. So unlike, say, a poker tell or blushing or something like that, by and large, it's hard to manipulate your expressions. But speech and the manifestation of our social relations is Machiavellian. So we can purposefully mislead and change things with our voice and our language. So this is a quote from a Who song. I saw the Who last week, and that was really fun. But Eminence Front, it's a put-on. So this is a... this is in 1861. This guy came up with these onomatopoetic names, and these are just so stories. And this is what makes a lot of these anthropological explanations pseudoscience. So the first bow wow theory was that language evolved because people were mimicking beasts and birds. Then he also coined the poo poo theory, which words evolved because of the need to express pain and pleasure. And then there was the ding dong theory, which was mirroring sounds, and the yo-hee-ho theory. When people work together like Volga boatmen, that's why they need language. And then there's the ta-ta theory, which the language mimicked the physical gestures of pantomiming. And these are all quite silly. So more apropos, and the father of modern linguistics was Ferdinand de Saussure, Swiss philosopher and linguist. So he... said that it wasn't really the speech that was important. It's ancillary comparison to the language. So the parole is secondary to the langue. And language is the system, and it exists like chess. It doesn't matter what color or what the pieces are made of. The rules exist in and of themselves. It doesn't matter what the weather is, what you bring to it. So the language is the system. And that even Chomsky, one of our most renowned linguists, says language does not exist. He has a non-existent theory, which he's quite serious about. And so structuralists like de Saussure look at how do these, how do people even learn to get along in social institutions? Language is just a feature, and it's not even worth studying, basically. So he poo-poos the poo-poo theory. All right, so that said, let's talk about human vocalization. So obviously the voice can also be used to laugh, to cry, or to scream, it's emoting, and to sing, which we love so very much, and which I will subject to you to later. Vocalization involves airflow, like any other wind instrument, and the larynx serves sort of like a reed, so it would be like analogous to a clarinet or a saxophone, bassoon, and then there are articulators downstream of the air, which control also the sound and the pitch and the tone. So the purpose of vocalization is often wrapped up with semiotics, which was what de Saussure founded. So that's just not really that big a deal. It's just a study of symbols. And within that is semantics, study of words, syntactics, the study of how the words relate in terms of grammar and meaning, and pragmatics, how they're contextualized. So it's just, you know, study of basically symbols, not just language. Tonality is an interesting thing that we don't get into a lot, even though it's part of the language. Basically, you could inflect, so the tone changes. So this is a prominent feature of Mandarin Chinese, Vietnamese. You go, and it's like all these little shapes. And actually, tonality is a major feature of most language families, the exceptions being very minimally inflected or intonated would be Korean and Japanese and Burmese. But most of the Sino-Tibetan language is also marginally inflected, but almost all African languages are. Indo-Europeans, of which most of the European languages, English, German, French, has deep roots in the Indo-European family, are not inflected except Punjabi, and some of the Native American languages are. Voices change. The boy's voice changed simply because it's hard for him to control the register change, and the cords thicken around age, let's say 14, 15, as a result of puberty, and the voice box growing. Another great way to recognize whether you're dancing with a transsexual in a club, I guess, the Adam's apple. Not that that would ever happen, but as we get older, a higher pitch occurs in men and a lower pitch in women. And then the volume, of course, as a result of the breath of life and the deterioration of the lungs, decreases. Also, there might be restriction of the diaphragmatic expansion because you're fat. So your pipes don't work as well, and your voice thins. You can't hold notes or sustain as long, and you have trouble being heard in noisy situations. Also, there's a tremor or shakiness of the voice, which is notable. So it doesn't hold the tone. It wobbles all around, and people speak slower, and they make more mistakes. So what causes that? Certainly, the master organ is the cortex, the brain. So you speak slower because your brain's spinning a little slower. The clock's wearing down. You're unable to code and encode language, and the prosody, which will go into the subtle meaning in context, is also harder to conjure and modulate and demodulate, shall we say. Also, your emotional, spiritual life can suffer. So obviously, if you are depressed or hopeless, then you can experience psychomotor retardation, and that would cause a slowing of your speech, and you know, you're not really inflecting, and you're kind of unenthusiastic. Many of my earlier webinars sadly are like that as I was going through a stressful time. Laryngeal nerves also directly control the larynx or voice box, of which the prominent feature or the reeds, if you will, would be the glottis or the vocal cords. And so they control the pitch, the tone, and the precision, and that would deteriorate with time as well, causing a tremulous, noisy, impure tone and a change in the timbre. Also, there's histological changes, as with any organ. The extracellular matrix and the collagen and the muscles all kind of deteriorate. It's like using a saxophone reed for 80 years. It's going to have issues. And then finally, the lungs, the chest wall, the ribs, the diaphragm, diaphragmatic excursion, and the actual alveoli, or the functional units of the lungs, all deteriorate with age. So it's like an accordion that is going bad. And also, deterioration of speech can result from loss of control of the tongue, that magical organ, the palate, the pharynx, which is all the upper tube where the food and the voice passes through, and the intonation can change because of the failure of coordination of the mouth, especially after stroke, of course. So what are the language centers? This seems kind of intimidating, but it's really pretty simple. Most people talk with the left side of their brain, that's language, and they feel with the right. Hence, language, math, logic, left, right is music, feeling, three-dimensional spatial. So the left front blue area there is called Broca's area, and we remember it as a mnemonic because it's babbling Broca. So if you have damage to this area, you're unable to really speak well. You can speak, but there's no prosody. There's no ability to really make the speech rich and meaningful. The little pink area is the primary auditory, which receives signals about pitch. And adjacent to that would be the Wernicke's area, which is when people can't speak because they can't understand what you're saying, that's damage on the left green area, the Wernicke's area. And then adjacent to that is the angular gyrus, which is this whole little cluster here. You get more and more abstraction. So the orange would be reading, numbers, social interaction, theory of mind, meaning that, you know, how is what I'm saying impacting you guys, and also spatial relations. And then up above that, the yellow would be the super, super abstract phonological, meaning what do these sounds mean, and the visual semantics. So anyway, it all kind of works together on this side to create language. And it's really pretty amazing that we can even go to a comedy club and laugh because it involves so many different layers of irony and prosody. Amusia is not amusing. As you remember, William Hung sang pretty badly on American Idol. Amusia means inability to detect tone, so you don't have music. And it appears that this could be a result of damage to the primary auditory cortex, but also the limbic system. And remember that the limbic system is emotional. So we come back to the realization, as we have with different lectures, brain injury, depression, addiction. The limbic system is how we encode everything. We are not able to function without feelings. And so the whole point of this is when you go to sleep, angry at somebody, then between the third and the sixth cycle, that spiritual cognition encodes as bad memories. So that's why they say don't ever go to bed angry at your spouse, because all learning is based on the limbic system, writing new neurons, and so it's very dangerous. So always better to go to sleep with gratitude, and then you will wake up in a better state because you are constantly coding. Remember, I always I tell my son, you can't change the future and you can't change the present, it's just unfolding, but the only thing you can change is the past. And I mean that quite sincerely. All history is revisionist, so we're always able to reframe what happened and do it in such a way that's empowering. So I certainly think that it's important to have a good attitude. Aha, prosody. I promised I'd get to this. So Rodney Dangerfield, you know, this guy who said, I don't get any respect. Obviously, there's a lot going on there in the rhythm, the stress of the words, and the intonation. So we knew he was doing a shtick and that he was, you know, a little artificially agitated and that he was showing the irony or the comedy of his situation with his wife, you know, take my wife, please, type of jokes. So anyway, prosody just is a general term for what it really means. I mean, you could have the text of what you're saying, but the subtext is also probably equally, if not more important. People say that body language is number one. Intonation, the way that you speak, the sounds are even more important. At least important is the tip of the iceberg is what you actually say. So certainly that holds true in human relations as well. People rarely remember what you say, but they remember how you make them feel, right? So the production of these, as we hear with Dawn later, the production of the prosody is impaired when we have the damage to that Broca's area, whereas the understanding of prosody is screwed up if you have a damage to the Wernicke's area. So this is what we call sensory aprosodia. So you just can't understand what people are saying. And so you can imagine that different autistic spectrum things might be dysfunction in that little angular area that controls the theory of mind and the ability to project or mirror other people's feelings. So anyway, this is very highfalutin, but it's an interesting topic. All right, we're going to go much to more pragmatic things. So this is the voice box, or the larynx. It adjusts the pitch and tone. It's an amazing instrument. And when you go abduction, meaning the chords, I haven't really shown them here, but I will in the final edit. If they go away from the midline, then you're voiceless. So it's like I'm talking and it becomes breathy because I let the chords go wide enough. Adduction, on the other hand, can cause it to go higher and then even stop. So it goes ha, and all these glottal stops are how we form words and syllables. So this is how we form words. So I'm kind of stopping the glottis. I'm closing it in a rhythmic way.
The stroboscopy light will now be turned on.
Articulator. So what the fricative is that? So this is a funny word, fricative. So fricatives are illustrated here. You can actually adjust. The first thing that's illustrated when I click this is the nasality. So you'll see that you can play with this little artificial mouth thingy. The back of the palate is open, is closed now to the nose, and it can be open. So you can adjust that. Let's play a little bit with this chart. So the lower lip against the teeth is fan, so fan, and if it's not voiced, it's fan. But once we start vibrating in the larynx and voice it, it's van, right? So we have there's no voice required for thin, but then when we voice it, it's van. There's sip, and then there's zip. And then there's pressure and pleasure. Susie and I often talk about the R's and the L's and voicing them, so we're having fun with that, too. It's a regular My Fair Lady over here. So trombone-like changes occur to the vocal tract, mainly using the tongue. So the tongue is like this penny whistle slide, and the tongue can obstruct up to 10 times, you know, and change the actual diameter of the vocal pipe. So that helps, too. Control. There's something called the singing formant, which it's not format, it's formant. So if you look at this chart on the bottom, speaking and playing instruments is a smooth curve based on the energy and the frequency. But then singers can amp up their voice somehow, and they create resonance like this mariachi guitar. It's something called singing formant. There's a typo there. So it involves dropping the whole voice box somehow and finding those resonances. We're going to talk to Jim Nations, who's an amazing four-octave singer. But it's I just love this term. It's the registers are called fries, vocal fries to the whistle. So a vocal fry, and this is the part you might want to turn down your audio for this, but I'm going to sing to demonstrate. So the vocal fry would be when you're glottis is very loose. Remember, we went so much, so loose and floppy that it disappeared and went voiceless. So this would be like Leonard Cohen, you know, and he would sing, Suzanne takes you down to her place by the water. Right. So that would be the vocal fry. The next register up would be modal voice, which is what everyone is used to, the head voice. This is a picture of Astrid Gilberto. one of my favorite singers. So she would be able, you have the best control in this modal voice. So it's the head voice, whereas the vocal fry is typically referred to as the chest voice. So the head voice would be like, I'm as busy as a spider spinning daydreams, like that. And then falsetto, we know, is when the chords are tight, tightly wound, and like Jersey Boys, or I'm sorry, Frankie Valli's Sherry. So that would be less expressive and high-pitched, like this. Sherry, baby, Sherry, baby. Like that. Sorry, I had to switch keys. And then there's the whistle, which I won't even bother to torture you with, but Mariah Carey has trained her ability to sing as a whistle, the very high frequency, and it's just amazing how she can get the pitch control that she does. So there's a debate between intelligent design. This giraffe seems to be quite ironic, or maybe was fed peanut butter like Mr. Ed. But he's saying, what the heck, because the main control of the vocal cord occurs via the recurrent laryngeal nerve, which is a branch of the vagus nerve. So what does that mean? The reason we bring up the giraffe is because it had to loop down from the brain, down from the vagus nerve, and go all the way down to the trunk where this arches, the arch of the aorta and the subclavian artery, because this recurrent branch loops under. So if it was intelligently designed, why would you make the nerve go that long? It's because of evolution, perhaps, that it was dragged down. The position of the heart is in the chest, and as the neck grew, so too did the distance this this nerve has to cover. If you have damage to the superior laryngeal, you have cricothyroid, the front part of the voice box doesn't work, and that's a different, less common lesion than the recurrent laryngeal, which is very vulnerable to injury both in the neck and the chest, and probably contributing to some of the cases that we'll hear shortly. The superior laryngeal is not as bad. You can still speak and you can still sing, but you have trouble going to the higher registers. So yodeling is switching registers. That's kind of fun. I feel like I never knew what yodeling was. So let's listen to the first. The first one is Don Houck, the 91-year-old gentleman who had two severe falls and brain injuries, traumatic brain injuries, and Ruth is caring for him. And so I got the chance to talk to him briefly, but he hadn't talked for many years on the phone, so it was not much of a conversation, but. After we hung up, she did call and say, oh, yeah, come to think of it, there was a change. So I want to just play for you her call. So Don has an expressive aphasia because his Broca's area is damaged. But actually, he can understand everything. So his Wernicke's area is intact. He also has articulation problems. He can't use his tongue against the palate properly to form words. But he communicates well with signing and gesturing and facial expression. So they're quite the pair. So let's hear what she has to say here.
Hey, Dr. Bark, this is Dr. Alk again. One thing I didn't mention to you when we were talking, his voice quality has gotten stronger. And that's a change. And I did ask him a moment ago, told him about your call, and said, well, he was asking about whether you were happier or more energetic or talking better, and he said yes to all three of them. So that's my message for now. Thanks.
I mean, I think 91 is kind of old, especially with two severe head traumas. So he's walking around with a cane now, but he's enjoying life. He's pointing out birds, and he's a steady a recuperation of a lot of his function, and his quality of life has improved quite a bit. Next on the cases is Vincent, who is a gentleman who's been taking for 27 months now at 4 capsules a night. And, you know, it's not a huge difference, but there is, I think, a detectable difference. And interestingly, after this is, we don't have a pre. This is after 6 months he's talking about sleep, I think. And I believe that instead of going up as you get older, in these particular gentlemen, the pitch did go up. But I think the timbre has changed, become richer and more confident, less tremulous. But see if you agree. I don't know. I don't want to bias it too much. But
no, I sleep deeper. You know, I woke up refreshed. Before, when I wake up, you know, years ago, I woke up, it looked like I was still dazed. You know, not quite a thorough sleep. Now I could sleep real well. Yeah.
Okay, that was 6 months. This is yesterday we spoke. And see what he sounds like.
I think I may be younger, but I'm not so sure. One thing I feel is I could sleep real well. And then in the morning, I can drop back to sleep if I need it. So after every morning, you know, I can feel refreshed, you know. Before, if I didn't sleep well, I felt foggy. Now, I sleep deeper, you know. I woke up refreshed. Before, when I wake up, you know, years ago, I woke up, it looked like I was still dazed, you know, not quite a thorough sleep. Now I could sleep real well, yeah.
Okay, so that's interesting. Moving right along, we have Carl Gittleman, who has gone to fantasy baseball camp again this year, and he went from being the starter and only 200 runs in 4 games. Now he's the closer, the Mariano Rivera, so still pitching in the 60s, still really good in terms of his speed and control, and not as good of a hitting year because he wasn't the starting pitcher. But let's hear what he has to say about his blood pressure, and just note that the speed and the tremulousness appears to have changed. This would be after the first 5 months of TA65, and he's starting to get a drop in his blood pressure, which is notable. Let's go into the blood pressure. That was interesting.
Yeah, the blood pressure is really interesting.
So you came in with a controlled blood pressure taking this combination pill, is it? Hydrocortisone and
Atacan.
Okay.
8 milligrams of Atacan. And I'd had for years sort of mildly high blood pressure.
But was it pretty stable? You weren't
And
getting...
then I got it very stable. Good. With the Atacan. We started at 4 milligrams. That didn't seem to do it. My blood pressure varied a lot during the day when I monitor it. So it would be normal. It sort of fooled me for a while because it was normal in the morning and at night, but it would go up during the day when I was out interacting.
And this is his voice in December after 21 months of TA65.
What's the blood pressure meds? You had been on 2 and then weaned.
We're off of blood pressure meds, and my blood pressure's running, you know, in a little bit high normal.
You had been on ones now?
I was on Atacan and hydrochlorothiazide.
So that's double. Now you're on nothing.
Now I'm on nothing. So I'm hoping that we'll see what happens. And I haven't had any of those sort of really weak, almost fainting spells, which I was getting because my blood pressure was so low.
So that illustrates a point that Ruth brought up yesterday, which is she has low blood pressure, 110 over 60, and her internist has never seen anybody get better with blood pressure, so she's hesitant to remove 3 drugs that she's on. So you got to be careful. This is one of the side effects occasionally of taking TA63. Your blood pressure can get too low, and that's not good for your brain and kidneys, and we don't need more than one head trauma in the Hauk family, so Dr. Hauk is going to redouble her efforts to stop or wean some of those. The next patient is Linda Nichols, who is 67, and she sent us this really nice picture of her doing the Pilates rocking horse. In yoga, we call this the floor bow or something, I don't know. Anyway, she claims, and you can kind of see it when you look at the thighs, how far off the ground they are. The angle appears to be about, 12 degrees, and then it goes up to about 20, perhaps. And also the angle of her T-spine, her thoracic spine, appears just below her elbows to come out at about 45 degrees now, whereas before it looked like about 35 or so. She's most excited about her neck and her arms, which tightened up almost as if she had had plastic surgery. And so she really is getting the bang for her buck in terms of always a hard worker, exercise-wise, but now it's really showing. Look at what she looked like. You know, I had an audio problem. Her voice is not this bad, actually. I had an audio problem, and I apologize, and I really, really messed that up. But let's see what she looked like in terms of, I'll draw attention to her platysmal bands, which are these neck bands, her arm tone, and generally her figure seems to have changed over a very short time. As you can see, I mean, she is a 67-year-old gal, but in great, amazing shape, and just loving it. So you just kind of get a feel. It's funny because age, you know, people get this thing where everyone says, oh, you look younger, and what is it that I can't put my finger on? This is almost good because we see the posture, the movement, the confidence, the gestures, the enthusiasm, and then also things like tone, timbre, rate. There are hundreds of visual and emotional and emotive and oral, A-U-R-A-L, cues that we get from people to guess their age. So let's go to the next one. This is Linda before, and this is Linda after 16 weeks of TA. And the thing that's very notable about Linda is that she had this horrible dysphonia. I mean, she sounded like this. She was talking, and her voice would drop out like that. And so that was perhaps as a result of surgery she had for sleep apnea. So sleep apnea is the collapse of the oral pharynx. So they had this procedure that basically they try and heat up that area and make it stiffer, sort of cook it so that it's stiffer and doesn't collapse as easily. But she believes it might have done some collateral damage to the innervation or the structures. We may never know. But certainly what you hear here in the after is it was a marked improvement. You'll just have to take my word for it and take her word for it because my recording messed up initially.
It was about 3 years ago, I think, I had a procedure called radiofrequency sonoplasty, which is used to hopefully correct sleep apnea problems. May have made my sleep apnea a little better. Unfortunately, it really affected it. Gave me some dysphonia.
Yeah.
Really affected my voice. Yeah. In the procedure, they actually cook the throat tissues with EMF to about 200 degrees. And that affected me. I started to get a very tremorous voice, a very soft. I lost volume. And it was hard for me to enunciate.
Yeah.
So I feel much improved since I've been on TA65. Huh. It does wax and wane, but in general, there's been a big improvement.
Yeah, I noticed that.
So I'm pleased.
Good. I noticed when you came in, your voice was very tremulous, especially in the lower, slower
register.
You
mean when I came in a few months
before taking TA? Quite a difference. So just the projection and the ability to sustain the tone seems better because it would kind of drop. The bottom would drop out. It was tremulous. So like,
yeah.
But it's good. I'm glad your voice getting stronger. So.
And it's getting better all the time.
Okay. Next to last is Sid Oldberg, a 72-year-old nuclear physicist, who in 85 experienced sudden onset of spasmodic dysphonia. So. Somehow the control or the innervation of his probably his recurrent laryngeal got messed up. And it doesn't seem to be Parkinsonian or part of that syndrome. In 2011, you know, the question of Parkinson's was raised as he developed a tremor, but by exclusion it was a benign essential tremor. So it doesn't really connect with the spasmodic dysphonia, as Parkinson's patients do have dysphonia as well. But this spirals are interesting tests that they do to measure tremor, and coordination. And you see here on the left is, I'm going to say about 3 months after starting, you can see the amplitude of the waves. The frequency is generated by the basal ganglia, I think, but the amplitude is higher, and the overall control intent is lessened. On the right, more recently in I think it was October, not sure. It's a pretty tight circle. It looks like a nice little pinwheel. And although the waves are there and the amplitude, the frequency is the same, the amplitude appears to my eye to be a little bit decreased. So here's Sid. This is before taking TA65. I think it's pretty pronounced, but it's horrible recording equipment. and I apologize for that. But listen for the tremulousness, the slowness, and the hesitancy here.
My first job was at Lawrence Livermore Laboratory in the Bay Area. And when I started, I knew nothing at all about nuclear engineering.
All right, so that's before, back in October of 2011. And then here is Terry now. And he's talking about his, I think he's talking about his basal cells. He used to have basal cell epithelioma, skin cancer, relatively harmless version, all over every 3 months, and then now there's been none for a while. So this would be him after 11 months of TA-65 back in September it was. So his voice quality appears to be different. And we'll play the original again just to compare and contrast.
Normally, you would find a lot of spots that have keratoses to spray with liquid nitrogen to kill the cells. This last time, he didn't find anything.
That's nice. So you go back every 6 months, he freezes something that looks like
a
keratosis that could develop into a basal cell.
Right, and he's not aware of my taking the TA-65, so it was a good blindfold, I guess.
I mean, you can tell if you want, but...
My first job was at Lawrence Livermore Laboratory in the Bay Area. And when I started, I knew nothing at all about nuclear engineering.
So I think a change in his timbre and his strength, multifactorial, of course, but... finally, let's talk about Jim Nations, who is the stage name of Garrett Harpel. He's 74 years old, sang in many stages across his life for many events, and has a love of music and singing that is unmatched. Tell me how long you've been taking the TA on and off, or how much you're taking?
Well, I've been on and off for about 3 years. Mm-hmm. What I noticed was coming from the outside, people start saying, you're looking younger. So people guess me from 15 to 30 years younger than I am.
Great.
And, of course, my voice is reflects the same.
What I go by mainly is what people say. What they started saying is, wow, you sound better than ever.
Okay.
You sound better than you did before. I like it, that kind of thing. I was afraid, I was so afraid, you know, that it would end up, you know, with a wobble or something.
Right.
And slow, but no, it has not.
So, he's live on the line, but let's listen to him singing Danny Boy. He also, again, all these webinars, after a few people say their voice got changed, and I see it, I hear it pretty commonly, that the timbre changes, and the sustain and the range. So that's why this webinar was born.
Oh, Danny boy, the pipes are calling from glen to summer's in the mail. am dead as dead I well may be. He'll come and find the place where I am lying, and kneel and say,
Jim, are you there?
Now I'm here, yes.
Good. So thank you for joining us. Your voice is amazing.
You're
that was really done last year.
Thank you.
No, thank you for sending me that. It's just beautiful. Can you tell us a little bit about your career as a singer?
My career in singing started actually when I was 10 years old. And continued when I was in the Army. I became the tenor soloist for the Army commander, for our company commander. That was a lot of fun. But I was involved in a kind of a secret mission to be involved in germ warfare. I didn't realize that at the time, but it made me very, very sick, and it you know, hit me from time to time, and of course it. When anything bothers your body, it bothers your voice. And so my career kind of went up and down through the years, but for the most part up. And I have recordings here this morning of when I was down and when I'm up. And finally, as I aged, it got to me more and more and more, and finally I decided that my career was over. Well, when I started taking TA-65, I started singing one day, I took the chance, and the people said, you know, your voice is not over. And the more I practiced, they said, you know, you're sounding better than you ever have. So I started back, and I don't know where it's going to end. Hopefully I'll just keep getting better as I age. Like wine.
That's
or like a violin.
So it was like a quantum shift.
Yes. Quantum shift. To back to my mid-40s and 50s, because what you listen for, and I'm really intrigued by how much you know about the voice. I would love to have that all in print so that I can read it and study it.
Okay. At 6 p.m. Last night, I didn't know anything about the voice, but apparently it came through in a way that you could understand, so that's good.
Oh, yes. Fantastic, and thank you so much.
Thank you.
But what I listen for in a voice is how fast is the vibrato, how vibrant is the vibrato,
mm-hmm.
and how much energy is the person putting out. And even now, you know, my energy level is extremely high. And my vibrato is fast as it was when I was in my 40s. And so it's just amazing, unheard of, actually. And by the way,
they say that singers do deteriorate with time. Like at the end, yeah. Billie Holiday had just barely an octave, which is all you need, I'm told, just an octave. But
yeah, right.
Yeah.
By the way, the other singers that you were trying to think of this morning, one was Pavarotti, mm-hmm. the other one is Domingo, and the other is Carreras. Is that right?
Placido Dominguez and Jose Carreras. I think you're right.
Yeah.
Good.
Mm-hmm.
Very good. Well, you should know that. That's your line of work.
Yeah, right.
But your voice has always interested me because it's got that sweetness to it, like a younger tenor, like a Enrique
yeah.
Caruso, and Enrique or whatever. And I wonder why that is, the sweetness of it, you know?
Boy, no, I don't know.
Do you know what I mean? The resonance has that very
yeah.
clear sound.
Yeah.
It doesn't have that billowy
yeah.
Pavarotti sound. I guess
yeah.
that's just how
right.
you're constructed. Well, good. So you really noticed, you know, a difference in your speech. How about other things? Have you noticed any difference in your appearance, or has anybody else?
My appearance, people started saying, Jim, you're looking younger. What are you doing? And of course, you can see in my picture there, that's a recent picture on my bicycle.
Okay. Yep.
I do ride, and I run. I couldn't take a picture of me running, but I will take a picture of me running and let you see that also. I hadn't run for many years because I couldn't. I was in pain and so forth. But now I'm running without pain and running fast. So it's my body.
That's great.
Definitely
yeah, I just
has noticed that. And sexually, I'm way younger. So
good.
Just amazing.
Yeah. You look good here, Jim.
Thank you.
So, you're on your bike here? Okay, that makes sense. That's where you're bowed
yeah.
for it. But, yeah, how's the hair coloring?
My hair coloring is mixed gray and dark brown, I would think. Dark brown and some gray. No, I do not.
Are you dyeing it? Oh, okay. That's not bad. Is the pepper
no,
coming
no,
back?
No, I do not dye it And everything is natural. I don't put anything on my face or anything. It's just, I am who I am.
Quoting Popeye. Or I am what I am. I am what I am. Well, okay, good. So I hope you enjoyed the kind of rambling talk there.
It was a lot of fun.
Thank you so much for being with us.
Oh, you're so welcome. It's nice knowing you, Dr. Park, and I'm looking forward to future visits.
Oh, yeah, it's going to be great. Next time you're down, swing by and visit us, okay?
Okay, all right.
Okay, too. Take care.
Okay,
bye.
Bye.
Ray did security for Rodney Dangerfield once. He's just as nice as you'd imagine to be. That's cool. All right, guys. Take care. Have a good day.
All the sounds of the earth are like music. All the sounds of the earth are like music. The breeze is so busy, it don't miss a tree. And an old weeping willow is laughing at me. Beautiful morning, oh what a beautiful day, I got a beautiful feeling.